Chapter 4. At first, I didn't see Kevin. I saw four astonished faces, four open pairs of eyes, four startled mouths. One man, a small middle-aged bloke with a thin moustache, started saying, "Who the..." Then Lee shut the door and I saw Kevin, who till then had been hidden by it. I always treasure the look on Kevin's face. Sometimes life really can be like the movies. This time it was. Kevin did one of those dumb double takes that they do in comedy films, and it was a beauty. He was casually asking, "What's the problem?" But he didn't get to finish the word problem. His chin dropped and his eyes looked like they would pop. His mouth started trying to form a new word, but his bottom lip couldn't get around it and just kept wobbling uncontrollably. The only sound that came out was a sort of w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w-w- but eventually he remembered how to hug. Lee joined in and we formed a clump of three, arms around each other, having a good rock. My old hassles with Kevin were all forgotten at that moment. When we'd had our hug, I took a look at the other men. They were watching and smiling, but as I brushed my hair back and wiped my eyes, the little guy with the mustache spoke up again. Sorry to be a party pooper, folks, but you'll have to get out of here. They'll be back at any moment. Can we take Kevin? I asked. They looked suddenly alarmed. No, no way, one of them said. They're right, Kevin said. I can't come with you. But we were hoping, I said. Look, Kevin said. You've got to go. Tomorrow we're working at the piggery. It's over to the... Yes, we know where it is. Okay, be in the bush behind it, on the top of the little knoll there, about lunchtime. I'll get away somehow, meet you for a few minutes. We can talk then. Okay. He hurried us through the door and we ran back past the well and the galvanized iron shed. Kevin went out onto the muddy brown track, then gave us a signal. Hurry, he said. As we ran past, he slapped my back. Take care, Ellie, he whispered. I was moved that he said that. I waved to him when I got into the tree line. Then the little procession of prisoners appeared from the direction of the lake, and Kevin immediately turned around and walked casually back to the sheds. Lee and I hustled on up to the others, who were busting to hear what we had to say. We were all wildly excited. I think we were so sick of each other's company that the possibility of welcoming Kevin back was wonderful for all of us. What did he say? Can we get him out? How'd he sound? How'd he look? He's lost a few Ks, hey? What did the others say? It took an hour before we calmed down, and then we spent half the night trying to figure out what we could do. At least it helped keep us warm. That night was even colder than the one before. Then about midnight, it started to rain. We crept down to a hay shed and burrowed in there for a sleep, but it meant we had to post a sentry. That was a drag. I did the first one but didn't sleep much after it anyway. When dawn came, I got up and went over to Homer, who was taking his turn. You go back to bed if you want, I said. I'm wide awake, so I might as well do sentry. I couldn't sleep either. Let's just talk. That way we might talk each other to sleep. So we talked, first time in a long time. We'd always been friends. We were practically raised together. But I'd been finding him suffocating in recent months, so I'd given him more room. Sometimes I just wanted to breathe my own air. Wherever there was Homer, there wasn't room for much else. We didn't seem to have the time for relationships these days. No, not the time, the energy. That's what we were missing. We were more selfish. I know that much. I used to have strong feelings about Homer, but now my strongest feelings were reserved for me, for keeping myself going. But we talked, mainly about what our world would be like if we ever won back our country. It had always been an article of faith with us that we would win. These days, though, seeing the colonists looking so settled, so comfortable, we had to admit that the odds were starting to tip against us. The effect on Homer was to make him more warlike. After it's over, he said, we've got to turn this country into a fortress. Everyone should be trained to use weapons, to fight. If anyone tries to invade us again, we've got to be ready, and if they do come, we've got to fight for every house, every street, every hectare. That's what we've got to do. Me, I had the opposite reaction. I told Homer my favourite story. Once upon a time, there was a village near a cliff. The road to the village was dangerous and lots of cars went over the cliff and crashed on the rocks below. The people in the cars got mashed up whenever that happened. Some of them even got killed, but eventually the village got a government grant to do something about it. Only trouble then was that the village got split into two groups. The people who wanted to build a fence around the top of the cliff and the people who wanted to buy an ambulance to put at the bottom of the cliff to cart the casualties off to hospital. Yeah, they shouldn't have waited for a government grant, said Homer, being smart. They should have done something about it themselves. That's a good story. Oh, Homer, you don't have to play dumb anymore. You're not at school now. Oh, you mean I've missed something? What kind of fence did they want to build? Very funny. I just think that it's no use having invaders pour into the country and then trying to do something about it. What we need to do is to help other countries get better income so that they don't feel any great urge to rush in here. That's easier said than done. How do we know? We never really tried. Anyway, turning the place into a fortress is hopeless. We haven't got enough people to do it properly, even if we wanted to, which I don't. I used to think there were too many people here before. Now look at it. Yeah, they're packing them in. Populate or perish. That was a motto in Grandma's generation. These guys are carrying it out for us. You and Lee are sure doing your best. What? What did you say? I started belting him around the head with my gloved hands. You take that back. Why don't you tell me he's still got some condoms left. Homer! I hit him a few more times. When I'd beaten him to a pulp, I said, anyway, I bet Fee's just waiting for you to ask her. He looked embarrassed at that. I don't want to get too serious, he mumbled. Well, it's either her or Robin. You don't have a lot of choices. Robin's a bit of a suck, don't you reckon? She's so perfect all the time. She reckons she's so good. No, she doesn't, I said loyally. Ah, well, I wouldn't ever want to go with her. She'd always be telling you what to do. She'd drive any bloke crazy. I was shocked at anyone criticizing Robin. She was one of my role models, along with Marilyn Monroe and Emily Dickinson. But Homer always had trouble getting on with strong-minded people, except me. No, even me sometimes. We could hear Robin and Fee talking back in the hay, so I went and joined them. This hay sticks into me so badly, Fee complained. In all those kids' books, people used to sleep in haystacks and it sounded really comfortable, but there's nothing comfortable about it. We had no need to move until 11 o'clock, so I got back into my sleeping bag and talked to them for a while before dozing off into a light sleep. We'd been trying to make do on two meals a day to save supplies, and breakfast was a meal I usually skip, so there wasn't much incentive to get out of the sleeping bag again. With the rain still falling and the temperature feeling close to zero, we didn't know if the prisoners would be taken off to work, but sure enough, right on 9 o'clock, we saw a little bedraggled file of men slopping across the paddock, followed by the guards in their ute. We let them go, glad that we could at least stay dry. Being a prisoner looked worse than working for my dad. As lunchtime approached, my nerves got more and more frayed. Kevin had the answers to a lot of questions that we'd been fretting on for a long time. If he could get away on his own for a few minutes, we would be able to have our first ever safe conversation with someone who'd been in the showground. I got so excited I found myself chewing on a corner of my sleeping bag. Of course, we all hoped he'd be able to rejoin us to bring our numbers back up to 6, but we knew there was some problem with escaping, or he would have done it yesterday. That was one of the things we wanted to ask about. We were in position above the piggery well before noon. The ute was parked there, so we assumed they were all inside, although it was 20 minutes before we saw any activity. Then one of the prisoners came out and got a couple of paintbrushes from the back of the ute. He gazed searchingly up the hill towards us for a minute. They must have all known we'd be there, but we didn't dare show ourselves. He soon went back inside. The next one to appear was Kevin. He came hurrying out, holding a shovel over his left shoulder. He came straight towards us, head down, like a man on a mission. As he got closer, I realized what the mission was. He had a roll of toilet paper in his hand. I started laughing. When he was only a couple of meters away from me, I called out softly, "Not here, you don't." He grinned, but he didn't slow down or raise his head until he was well inside the belt of trees out of sight of the piggery. Then Robin, Homer, and Fee had the chance that Lee and I had had the day before. There were heaps of hugging. There was heaps of hugging. It was only the fear of time that put a stop to it. But even so, the whole time that Kevin was talking, Fee stood beside him holding his hand and stroking it. We were very happy to see him, but soon the questions started flooding in, till Kevin had to put his hand up to stop them. Whoa, whoa, guys, hold the phone, one at a time. How's Corrie? I asked quickly before anyone else had a chance to ask anything else. Depends on who you talk to. I haven't seen her since the night she got shot. In fact, I heard that you guys have seen her since I have. Look, I'd say she's about the same, still in a kind of coma. Some people say she's worse because she's still losing weight, but other people say they're sure she hears them when they talk to her. I don't know. People think what they want to think. No one's got any definite info. How are all our families? Not bad, the last time I saw them. I've been out with these work parties quite a while, but everyone was looking okay a few weeks back. I mean, it's all relative, isn't it? You guys look a lot healthier than anyone at the showground, but now that people are getting out and working again, they're starting to pick up. Kevin seemed older and more mature somehow, more intelligent even. He'd never have said, it's all relative, or people think what they want to think, when he'd been camping with us in hell. This war had changed us all, and not always for the worse. What's it been like? Homer asked. Suddenly, at this simple question, Kevin seemed to fall apart. His face crumpled, and for a minute he couldn't get his words out. Fee gripped his hand tighter, and I patted his back. He hardly needed to say anything. He'd already answered the question. Sorry, he stammered. Sorry. Has it been terrible? Robin asked gently. Kevin just nodded. They're okay as long as you do what they say, but the moment you do something they don't like? I was thinking again of how badly Kevin had been beaten up when he arrived at Wirrawee Hospital with Corrie. I didn't know any details, but my imagination made up for that. I'll have to go back in a sec, Kevin said. Can't you escape? Homer asked urgently. What's stopping you? Kevin shook his head. They keep hostages, members of your family. If you escape, they execute them. They've got us by the balls. The only reason they guard us is to stop us sabotaging or stealing things and to make us work hard. There's no way anyone can escape. He turned to go back. I felt desperately sorry for him. He looked so lonely and miserable at having to return to such a rotten life. If it could be managed, would you want to escape? I asked. Would you want to join up with us again? He looked shocked. Of course, but if you can think of a way to do it, I'll say you're a genius, Ellie. I'll even put that in writing. I grinned. Privately, I was thinking, get your pen out. I didn't say it because I didn't want to raise his hopes too much, but I already had the glimmerings of an idea.